1 Corinthians 14, verse 34. Let your women keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. And if they will ask anything, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is a shame for women to speak in the church. I want to say all praise to the Most High Yahweh, Bahashem Yahweh Shai. Double honor to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone. Enough respect to the brothers teaching the truth all over the earth. This lesson is going to be entitled, What is a Prophetess? And it's going to be in response to a comment I received from this video that I put up yesterday. The video is entitled, Galatians 3:28 is not permission to be a homosexual or woman preacher. Okay, so just to show you, of course it is me there, right? And the lesson was fiery, of course. Now on the comment board this morning, not that long ago, I received a comment from an individual known as 12 of J, whichever, whatever that means, right? Now the person says this, and this is why I'm doing the lesson. Okay, it says, so just reading it straight, it says, as I have asked another brother from this camp before, if the Most High did not deal with women at all of his holy nation of Israel and there were no prophetesses at all, please explain these scriptures to me. And then she has a list of scriptures here, right? Isaiah's wife, which that's part of the answer right there. Isaiah's wife, Anna, tribe of Asher, Acts 2:17, 18. Who are these daughters and handmaids of the Most High? Being a smart ass, right? Acts 21:8 through 9, the daughters of Philip. And there are three books of the Bible for women, one of which isn't even an Israelite, or unless you say she is, I don't debate. But Ruth, Esther, and Judith. I need clarity on this, please. Now listen to this. I understand not teaching being called a pastor and usurping authority over men. That is indeed out of order. But to say he doesn't deal with his daughters at all on that level, and that there are no prophetesses, I don't believe is 100% according to scripture. Also, when 1 Corinthians 10:5 says to be covered while prophesying or praying, then that means they will be prophesying, correct? And to correct you on that is 2 Corinthians 10:5, not 1 Corinthians 10:5, because I looked it up. Oh, you know what? I'm wrong. No, I'm right. It's 2 Corinthians 10:5. Is it? No, I'm sorry. 1 Corinthians 11:5. So I still, yeah, so she was still wrong. Anyhow, I answered back. This is my reply. I said, first off, I never said that the Most High doesn't deal with women. And when you watch this video, I never uttered that, not one time. I never said in this video the Most High don't deal with women. I said there are no prophetesses, as in teaching the scriptures. Women preachers is what I was talking about. I never said one time that the Most High don't deal with women. He ain't dealing with women on that level. I know of all these scriptures you brought up, but none of those scriptures describe any women teaching. That's just a person that feelings are hurt. Now, let's read a little bit more of it here. So I said, first off, I never said the Most High doesn't deal with women. I said there are no women preachers. And then I read Judges 4:4, which we'll read. Well, you know, we'll read it now. Judges 4:4, and Deborah, a prophetess. See, the word is clearly in the scriptures. The wife of Lapidos, she judged Israel at that time. I said, here the term prophetess equals a prophetess or generally inspired woman. By implication, a prophetess, by association, a prophet's wife, prophetess. And I said, do you see teacher or preacher in the definition? I said, no, you don't. And then I said, and it's backed up by this, Judges 5:1, then saying Deborah and Barak, the son of Abinoam, on that day, right? And then I said, the way women prophesy, they either have a dream or a vision, then they tell their husbands or prophets, and they break down the vision. Also, women can prophesy through song, be a poetess, right? They prophesy through song. So really, the way that it is, prophesying the Bible doesn't always mean you teaching the truth. Prophesy, you can have a dream or a vision, and you come and tell your husband or the intended individual, right? Or you tell the prophets and they break the vision down if you don't understand it. That's how it goes. So let's get into this a little bit. And then I said, let me be nosy and go on this person's page. Now, didn't the girl just say she understand that teaching is out of order? Didn't she say that when you go to her page? Look at this. Look at this. This is a nigga woman, man. Okay. The importance of remembering Leviticus, the importance of remembering Revelation, remembering John 4:22, Revelation, blah, blah, blah. You see, the whole damn page worth of video, you running your mouth, and the Most High never set you up in that office to do that, okay? You going off. And that's why you know, the video that I made, it cut you. You know, you got cut through the spirit. That's why you asking them questions like that. You being a damn demon, right? And mind you, I didn't block her. I wanted to see what her response was going to be, but she ain't respond yet. Now, she asked the question 2 hours ago, and an hour ago, which was almost 2 hours ago, I responded. And no response as of yet, you see? So putting up a list of scriptures that show that women were called prophetess, or that women were there, that doesn't mean anything. When you look into the scriptures, first off, let's read these. I'm going to read 1 Corinthians 14:34. Let your women keep silence in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. And if they will learn anything, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is a shame for women to speak in the church. That's plain. That's plain and to the point. And it starts off saying, verse 33, for the Most High is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints. Meaning what? What would confusion be? Confusion would be you having women in there preaching. This backs it up. 1 Timothy 2:11. Let the women learn in silence with all subjection. With all subjection. And I went into that in this lesson. What subjection was, what it meant. We brought up several scriptures. Subjection means under the rule of. You're under the rule of your husband. Okay. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection. But I suffer not a woman to teach. Period. Stop. There's a comma there. But stop. I suffer not a woman to teach. Right? A second thing. Nor to usurp authority over the man, but to be in silence. If you were the lead speaker in a church, you would have to be an authority over men. Would you not? It's not your office. The office of a preacher, teacher, prophets, as it were, are men. You people in American culture, you don't know how to look up words. And it's right here, right in your face. You see? Now, many people will say, that's Paul speaking. Well, look, Paul did say it, right? But it's in the Bible. And what did Yahushua say? Lo, I come in the volume of the book. And Yahushua taught Paul directly. Knocked him off the horse at Damascus Road. You can't say you spoke to Yahushua, right? Now, when you do a word search on the word prophetess, right? You're going to get several scriptures. And they always mean, in the Old Testament, they mean the same thing. Matter of fact, let's click on one so people don't say that. All right. Now, let's just go here to Judges 4, because I looked at that definition on my phone. When you look it up here on the blue letter, on either an iPad or on the desktop, you might get a little bit different definition. Right. It says what? Listen, prophetess, ancient type endowed with gift of song. Then it gives it. Who was it? Miriam. Later type consulted for a word, Huldah. False prophetess, no idea. Wife of Isaiah the prophet. Where does it say teachers on here? See that? In the Old Testament, whenever the word came up, prophetess, it's one of those definitions. Either the woman was a false prophetess, told lies, they was a wife of a prophet, or they were consulted for a word, which was in the case of Huldah, ancient type endowed with the gift of song. They sung songs or they were poetesses. That's how they prophesied. Maybe they was given a dream or a vision. Look here, a prophetess, generally an inspired woman, by implication a poetess, by association a prophet's wife, prophetess. You never see teachers there. In the Old Testament, it's not there. The Most High never had women preachers. Okay? And this girl is going off, whoever you are. Now, let's go back to the search. Come on, talk on it. So here in Exodus 15:20, it's backed up. It says, and Miriam the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took a timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her with timbrels and with dances. She was a prophetess. She prophesied with song, right? You can only imagine that the same thing. And here it says Huldah. She was the wife of a guy, right? She was consulted for a word. And I'm not gonna sit here and read all the scriptures, but it told you that. You're never gonna see anywhere in here where a woman preached. Okay, now I did have now as we read in Judges 5, when it said then, I actually got it up here. Let's go here. Judges 5:1, it says, then sang Deborah and Barak the son of Abinoam on that day, saying, and then they had a song they sung. That was also how, that's how Deborah did her prophesying. She sang a song, right? And she may did other things or whatever it is, but it, but the meaning is there. Now, when you go here, let's go to the New Testament. The New Testament is going to say something a little bit different. Luke 2:36, and there was one Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age and had lived with her husband 7 years from her virginity, right? The word prophetess only shows up twice in the New Testament. Now, what we know about the Old Testament, did the Most High ever have women preachers? No, never at any time. So let's go to the New Testament and look up the word, because it's Greek. So obviously the word is going to mean something different, right? Or it's going to have a little bit different definition. So when you look up prophetess here, right, it's prophetess. And when you go and you look up the definition now, it says a prophetess, a woman to whom future events or things hidden from others are at times revealed, either by inspiration or by dreams and visions. A female who declares or interprets oracles. Boom. A female foreteller or an inspired woman prophetess. Did it say teacher? Did it say preacher? Did it say she was on the streets breaking down scriptures? Nope. Did it say she was standing teaching men? Nope. Did it say she was up there in front of everybody like Juanita Bonham, showing her ass, going all crazy? I'm a prophetess, woman of the Lord. Nope. So when I answered her correct, I was correct. And now it doesn't want to give me the full definition. Let's refresh it. See, you people in America, you don't understand nothing. And you constantly trying to find fault with us when we bring out the truth. And this right here, do you know women are not allowed to speak in church? That's accurate. Your mouth need to be closed. Now here we got, let's see. Maybe she said something back. Nope. And that's another bug, that woman asking something dumb. You people are stupid. You think when the scriptures say the Lord was hung on a tree, that it means he was hung by the neck. He was crucified, man. Hung on a tree simply means what? What's a cross made out of? It's made out of wood. Good Lord. Anyway, here the term prophetess or inspired woman, by implication, a prophetess by association of the prophet's wife, prophetess. Do you see teacher or preacher in the definition? No, you don't. And when you go over here, even in the New Testament, you never see it. Teacher or preacher, a prophetess, a woman to whom future events or things hidden from others are at times revealed. And I said that a woman can get a vision, she can get a dream, and then tell people. I never said the Most High to do that, because it's in the Bible. What about Manoah's wife? I think her name was Hannah, right? What about Elizabeth, John the Baptist's mother? What about her? What about Mary? What about all these different women in the scripture that had dreams and visions, that saw angels and talked to them? I would never say something so damn stupid, right? I said the way women prophesy, they either have a dream or a vision, then they tell their husbands or prophets, and they break down the vision. Boom. Exactly what I said, right? That's it. Let's go on. Now let's read a few of these scriptures that come up, because she brought it up. This is Joel 2 verse 28. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. Now when we looked at, and let's also finish read here, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaids, in those days will I pour out my spirit, and I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. Now, knowing what we know about the Old Testament, what we read so far, when the scripture says here prophesy, we're going to look it up. We know the woman's role and the man's role. Did the Most High ever in any time when dealing with a woman called a prophet and say that she was a preacher or a teacher? Of course not. So when it says here, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. What could this mean? And the word has several definitions. You got to find the one that's going to fit the office, right? To prophesy under influence of divine spirit of false prophets. To prophesy under influence of divine spirit of false prophets. I.e. to speak or sing by inspiration and prediction or simple discourse. Prophesying makes self a prophet. So if you know that women don't teach, right? Is this going to be applied to the daughters as teachers? Of course not. It's going to be applied to them as singing, right? Even speaking. They may speak and tell somebody of a thing that they heard, that the Most High showed them in a vision or a dream. As the brothers that teach the truth, many of their wives have dreams and visions. They tell them about the dream and vision. The brothers made videos and break it down to the congregation. That's happened 1,000 times, right? It's happened 1,000 times. But you know that it don't mean you're going to go and set up a camp and you're going to teach. You're going to go and be among men. And then this damn girl says she knew that was out of order, but yet she's still doing it. Why? Because she's a damn demon. That's why. She's rebellious, a rebellious daughter of Israel. That's why. You see? So now let's also look up handmaids, because she mentioned that. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids, in those days will I pour out my spirit, right? What's a handmaid? What is that? You really don't want to be that. Because I looked it up already, but let's just do it. It says here, handmaid, maid, maid servant, bondwoman, maiden, woman servants, handmaids, bondmaid, servant, wench, maid, maid servant, slave girl, maid, maid servant is belonging to a mistress of a dress, speaker, humility. Now, is this going to be a speaker in an open forum? No. Because as you go on and you look it up right here, to spread out as a family, a female slave as a member of the household, bondmaid, maid servant, maiden, wench, bedwoman, bondwoman, woman servant. You see? And even here when you look in the Jacinius lexicon, you don't see it anything there either, right? So of course we know, after all the things we read and looked at, the Most High ain't gonna say here that it shall prophesy. And you know it's talking about as in a woman's sense, that it ain't teaching. So why is he gonna come back here and say she's gonna be out there speaking and teaching? It's not there, man. Let's go on. Acts 2, the same scripture in the New Testament, quoting what was written in that book of Joel, Acts 2:16. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith the Most High, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens will I pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. We're going to look that up too. Well, we're going to look it up here. So it's going to be the same word. And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and notable day of the Lord come. Now, let's look it up here. Let's just look it up. Right? In the last days, saith the Most High, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. In the Greek, what does this word say? Now, we already know in the past, the Most High never had any women preachers. And in the New Testament, what did Paul say? He suffers not a woman to teach. It's not there. Now, when you go here, of course, you got several definitions to prophesy, to be a prophet. In the prophetic sense of preaching the word, you know that's going to be for men, because it says they shall prophesy. You got to apply the right definitions. Speak forth by divine inspirations, that could be a woman. To predict, that could be a woman. With the idea of foretelling future events, especially pertaining to the kingdom, that could be a woman. To utter forth, declare a thing which can only be known by divine revelation, that could be a woman. To break forth under sudden impulse in lofty discourse or praise of the divine counsels. Lofty discourse is probably not woman, but praise of the divine counsels, that could be female. Under light prompting. Now it says here to teach, you think, and refute, reprove, admonish. None of those are going to be a woman's office. Comfort others, perhaps. To act as a prophet, discharge a prophetic office. Of course, obviously that's not a woman, right? To foretell events, divine, speak under inspiration, exercise a prophetic office. So you're going to have certain definitions that apply to the men, and then certain definitions that can apply to both. But this definition could only apply to men. Exercise the prophetic office. Be a prophet, as in Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, right? And she went on to say there were books in the Bible named after women. You said for women. That's not true. Those books are not just for women. Let's go back and read her comment. She said, let's see. The book of Micah was a prophet, that was a man. Now The Daughters of Philemon. There are three books of the Bible for women. That's not true. The book of Esther wasn't for women. The book of Judith wasn't for women. And neither was the book of Ruth. They was for the Israelites in general. Right? And they all had a lot of different meanings in the books. But a lot of things happened. They weren't written specifically for women. So you're getting your clarity. Now again, I need clarity on this, please. I understand not teaching, being called a pastor and usurping authority over men. Would you, if you understand it, why are you over there trying to teach? That is indeed out of order. Yeah, and you out of order. Let's go on though. Back in the scripture again. So we looked up prophesy. Now let's look up handmaidens. Over here in the Greek. Looks like the word dole, which I'm not going to bother with the pronunciation because it's unimportant. A female slave, bondmaid, handmaid. A female slave, involuntary or voluntary. See? Which really in this day and age, we don't have female slaves, right? So it's just going to mean a woman that's, you know, that the Most High dealing with in visions and in dreams. You see? There it is. That's all that you see. Now when you go to 1 Corinthians 11 and 5, which he brought up, it says, but every woman that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered dishonoreth her head, for that is even all worn as if she were shaven. Now we done looked at the term, but let's just go ahead, you know, for the sake of doing it, because when the women are going to prophesy, but they ain't going to be out there teaching the word. They're not going to be teaching men, right? But let's just see what it says. And it's the same definition as what we just read and broke down. You're gonna have to apply the right definition. We know it ain't talking about the be down breaking up. It's not to teach, right? We know that ain't it. It ain't to teach. All these other definitions here that imply what when a woman prophesies, what she's gonna be doing. And we got history backing us up. Plus, what did Paul say in 1 Corinthians and in Timothy? What was written there, right? The Most High is not the author of confusion. See, there are not going to be any women preachers. Now, I'm going to say this. A lot of you people out there try to accuse us and saying, like, we, just because the ministry is dominated by men, that's the way that it's supposed to be. And you got brothers putting it up on the comment board. 1 Corinthians 14:34 through 40, excuse me. See? Even women on the comment board agreeing with the lesson. Maria Clark, every single word of this, I love your channel, straight shot, no chaser. See? And I didn't say nothing wrong. I didn't go off. Another one of the sisters giving a salute, fire lesson, and she said, so this chick that's got a problem, she the one going off. It's your guilty conscience that's speaking. And you could have just did what I just did and then and have known and kept yourself from going off. But yet you still over here going off. You look familiar. I don't know exactly where from, but you look familiar, but you've been going off though. Need to shut that channel down and stop trying to teach because you're going off. Now, what I was going to say was, let me look something up. People love to accuse us and act as if we saying that women are not, part of the truth or whatever. Statements like that have been made, but we didn't mean it in that way when brothers said that. Brothers mean that the truth and the teaching of the truth is not for women. Right? As you got an ongoing debate where this guy was, or somebody been going around saying women are part of the 144,000, but they're not. Because the brother, the elder from Dallas has been dealing with that. Let's go over there and look at that real quick. Because you got a lot of demons these days pushing that false doctrine that women are part of the 144,000. You're not part of the 144,000. You're part of the elect. Matter of fact, I was just about to start, you know, I've been making lessons so much, I haven't had that much of a chance to watch a lot of lessons. Come on, computer. Excuse me. But this elder and brother just put together two different lessons dealing with this, right? You got women are not a part of the 144,000 priesthood because they can't teach. It's forbidden. And then also a response to the late lady. See? Because somebody will put these comments on the comment board. You got a bunch of demons doing that right now. But you getting shut down left and right. And you got that rumor out there sending these lies saying that, you know, the Most High ain't dealing with women. That sister even said that. I never said Most High wasn't dealing with women on that level. Because obviously he is. He'll give them visions and dreams, right? There are women that, and I'm going to show you a few examples before we close out here. But I did this lesson not that long ago. What? October of the past year. It's called Dear Sister, an Exhortation to the Hebrew Israelite Women. See? So don't sit there and act like, you know, we biased against women. No, we just all about the 100% truth. We tell the truth and we teach. Also, if I can find it, on one of the old camp channels. If I can find it, let's see here. One of the old camp channels, years back, on the street, me and the brothers, at the time, guys that were brothers, we went into a whole lesson dealing with the women. She had washed my feet with her tears. We were dealing with the women. So don't, you know, you pick the wrong person coming on the comment board talking that shit, okay? Because we went all into it that day, all into different, you know, scriptures dealing with, like I said, you know, look, the story of Tabitha and Israelite women's, let me try to get the title, the story of Tabitha and Israelite women's outstanding deeds. So you got the wrong guy, okay? You got the wrong guy. You damn demon ass women out there, man. I can't help your feelings hurt and you feel left out, but the Most High didn't set you up to teach. You're not for the ministry, okay? Also, you're not a part of the 144,000. You're part of the elect, though. Now, to show you that, this is Ezekiel 14 and verse 13. It says, "This son of man, when the land sinneth against me by trespassing grievously, then will I stretch out my hand upon it and will break the staff of the bread thereof, and will send famine upon it, and will cut off from man and beast from it. Though these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it, they should deliver but their own souls by their righteousness, said the Lord power. And these three men are of the 144,000, and they are of the elect. If I cause noisome beasts to pass through the land, and they spoil it, so that it be desolate, that no man may pass through because of the beasts, though these three men were in it, as I live, said the Lord power, they shall deliver neither sons nor daughters, they only shall be delivered, but the land shall be desolate. Or if I bring a sword upon that land and say, sword, go through the land, so that I cut off man and beast from it, though these three men were in it, as I live, said the Lord power, they shall deliver neither sons nor daughters, but they only shall be delivered themselves. Or if I send a pestilence in that land and pour out my fury upon it in blood to cut off from it man and beast, though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, said the Lord power, they should deliver neither son nor daughter, they shall but deliver their own souls by their righteousness. For thus saith the Lord power, how much more when I send my four sword judgments upon Jerusalem, the sword and the famine and the noisome beast and the pestilence to cut off from it man and beast. Yet behold, therein shall be left a remnant that shall be brought forth, both sons and daughters." And I bring this scripture out all the time. Women are part of the elect, the 1/3, but not the 144,000. And you're not teachers, you're not preachers, you're not prophets, as were out on the corners bringing out the truth. If any women out there teaching, you going off, you better stop. "Yet behold, therein shall be left a remnant," that's the elect, "shall be brought forth, both sons and daughters. Behold, they shall come forth unto you, and you shall see their wearing their doings, and ye shall be comforted concerning the evil that I have brought upon Jerusalem, even concerning all that I have brought upon it. And they shall comfort you when ye see their ways and their doings, and ye shall know that I have not done without cause all that I have done in it, saith the Lord power." So when the destruction, when this Jacob's trouble pours out, the Most High said he's going to bring a remnant forth, both those sons and daughters. 2 Corinthians 6:14, "Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath the anointed, or the Hamashiach, with Belial, which is Satan? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of the Most High with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. And as the Most High hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you. Ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty." So again, I never said the Most High wasn't dealing with women at all. I never said that. I don't know where you got it from, this chick that said it, but you was going off. You bearing false witness. Now, if somebody said that, you have to take into account what they were saying. You know, if you say, "Oh, the Most High ain't dealing with the women," it just means I know what brothers have said, uttered that, But what they were saying was the Most High deals with women on the level of teaching, because you're not to teach. Plain and simple. Now, even in the old days when Israel went through shit, we went through the curses, we went through tribulation, the women were there present, and you had those of the women that were noble, that had noble deeds, right? Now I want to read, I don't want to have to read all of this, but this is when King Antiochus, the damn wicked, 1 Maccabees 1:41, moreover King Antiochus wrote to his whole kingdom that all should be one people, and everyone should leave his laws. So all the heathen agreed according to the commandment of the king. Yea, many also of the Israelites consented to his religion and sacrificed unto idols and profaned the Sabbath. You see, for the king had sent letters by messengers unto Jerusalem and the cities of Judah that they should follow the strange laws of the land. You see what's going on here. And forbid burnt offerings and sacrifice and drink offerings in the temple, and that they should profane the Sabbaths and festival days and pollute the sanctuary and holy people. Set up altars and groves and chapels of idols and sacrifice swine flesh and unclean beasts, that they should also leave their children uncircumcised and make their souls abominable with all manner of uncleanness and profanation. Why did they do it? To the end that they might forget the law and change all the ordinances. And whosoever would not do according to the commandment of the king, he said he should die. See? In the selfsame manner wrote he to his whole kingdom and appointed overseers over the people, commanding the cities of Judah to sacrifice city by city. Then many of the people were gathered together unto them, to wit everyone that forsook the law, and so they committed evils in the land, and drove the Israelites into secret places, even wheresoever they could flee for succor, cities of safety. And it says, now the 15th day of the month Kislew, in the 145th year, they set up the abomination of desolation upon the altar and builded idol altars throughout the cities of Judah on every side, and burnt incense at the doors of their houses and in the streets. And when they had rent in pieces the books of the law which they found, they burnt with fire. And wheresoever was found with any the book of the testament, or if any consented to the law, the king's commandment was that they should put him to death. Which means the damn Edomites was going crazy, right? And they wanted to stop the Israelites from keeping the law. Why? To keep the Most High from being, you know, from us being without God. Because if you turn away from his law, you turn your back on him, then he turns his back on you. You see? So this is what the devil did. That's why they got a Christianity doctrine now, saying the law was done away with, to separate the Israelites from their God. Now during this time, it was heavy persecution, right? Listen close. Thus did they by their authority unto the Israelites every month to as many as were found in the cities. They were putting to death people that was keeping the law, or that circumcised their children. Now the five and 20th day of the month they did sacrifice upon the idol altar which was upon the altar of the Most High. They put a pagan altar on top of the Most High's altar. At which time, according to the commandment, they put to death certain women that had caused their children to be circumcised. And they hanged the infants about their necks and rifled their houses and slew them that had circumcised them. See? So these women went against the commandment of the king to keep the law instead, and they died. That's a noble act, right? Committed by women. Howbeit, men in Israel were fully resolved and confirmed in themselves not to eat any unclean thing. Wherefore they chose rather to die, that they might not be defiled with meats, and that they might not profane the holy covenant. So then they died, and there was very great wrath upon Israel. So you people out there with the hurt feelings, man, you got the wrong people. So we bring out all the truth. And also, don't forget 1 Maccabees is in chapter 7. That story, if I got the right chapter. And I might have it wrong. Let's see. It may be 2 Maccabees. Let's see if it is. But don't, you know, you can't forget that story. And I don't know if I got it right. Yeah. 2 Maccabees chapter 7. It came to pass also that 7 brethren with their mother were taken and compelled by the king against the law to taste swine's flesh, and were tormented with scourges and whips. And you read this story, they all got tortured, the mother included. They all got tortured and put to death behind not eating swine's flesh. It's similar to what we read in 1 Maccabees, man. You see? Yeah, and you just got to go read the story because it's too lengthy for me to read it now. But that's, you know, more deeds of, you know, great Israelite women. You see, great Israelite women. And I would never say, you know, y'all got it wrong, man. Just because we bring out the truth, we got to bring out the truth the way it's supposed to be taught. But I would never sit here and say the Most High don't deal with women. Okay, you got to have balance when you teach, right? Just like you got to let women that, you know, also follow, you know, women that follow Yahweh Shai during the time he taught in his ministry, you know. If she women are part of the truth, anybody that watched me, them sisters can testify to that fact. This is 1 Timothy 5 and 9. It says, let not a widow be taken into the number under 80 years old, having been the wife of one man, well reported of for good works, if she have brought up children, if she have lodged strangers, if she have washed the saints' feet, if she have relieved the afflicted, if she have diligently followed every good work. Right? So the women are there, as I brought out in Corinthians and in Ezekiel. The women are there in the end. So no, you ain't got no case over here, lady. You know, whatever your name, 12 of J, whatever your name is, but you're going off for teaching anyway. But the good thing about this, you made that comment, is that others got edified by your lack of understanding, you see. And maybe now even you will understand and repent. All right, that's it. So what is a prophetess? A prophetess is not a female version of the prophets. That's not what a prophetess is. And that's going to do it. So Lord willing, you will edify, you know, you and watch this lesson, and you're going to see it today at camp. All right, this is camp day. So you'll see the bulletin pop up soon. All praise to the Most High Yahweh, Bahashem Yahweh Shai. Double honor to the apostles and elders of Great Millstone. Enough respect to the brothers teaching the truth all over the earth. See you again soon with another lesson, Lord willing. Shalom.